2019, International Astronomical Union held a competition to assign names to stars and planets as a part of its centenary celebration under Name Exo World campaign. And the HD86081, a yellow white dwarf star, was India was asked to name it and its exoplanet orbiting close to the star. And the name chosen was, the star was named Bibha, and the planet was named Santamasa, which means clouded. As all of you mostly know, that Bibha in Bengali means a bright beam of light. Bibha Chowdhuri was born in Calcutta in 1913, and her father was a doctor and her mother belonged to Brahmo Samaj. They were six brothers and sisters. All were very well educated, but all of them remained unmarried. And so that's why it's difficult to get much of her information. She studied in Bethune Collegiate School and then in Herembo College. She did MSc Physics in 1936 from Rajapur Science College. Bibha Chowdhuri was asked by an interviewer for Manchester Herald that why did she take physics? She says that she took to followed her inclination to do physics. And she approached Professor D.M. Bose, who was there in Science College. And then he shifted to Bose Institute as the director. And the research topic was cosmic rays. Cosmic rays are high energy charged particles, mainly protons and atomic nuclei. And they produce electromagnetic showers consisting of charged particles and photons entering the Earth's atmosphere. Initially, it was thought that it's electromagnetic radiation, but the term cosmic ray was coined by Millikan, who made measurements of ionization due to cosmic rays, and he said that the primary cosmic rays are gamma rays, that is photons. Cosmic rays provided a laboratory for studying fundamental particles. In 1932, Anderson discovered positron, the antiparticle of electrons, from tracks left by cosmic ray particles in a cloud chamber. Then in 1936, Anderson and Neumayer discovered a particle with same charge as electron but a higher mass. They called it mesotron. Later, this came to be known as muons. Meanwhile, in 1925, Marietta Blau and her student Hartha Wambacher in Vienna demonstrated the use of photographic plates as detectors of to record tracks of charged particles. In 1932, they placed these specially designed emulsion plates about 7,500 feet above sea level on a mountain near Innsbruck at Hesse's Haffelker Observatory. And when the plates were developed, they found plenty of cosmic ray tracks, mostly protons. So, in 1937, they found a star-like event, which they called disintegration star. So, you can see here, I don't know if it is clear, you can see that, you know, this is like a star, this portion, and these are tracks. So, this was the evidence of disintegration of heavy nuclei by cosmic ray protons. So, these cosmic ray protons interacted with the material of the film, maybe silver or bromine, and they produced this, they had this disintegration. So this was a star-like figure, was star-like, was observed. The photographic plate method was also used in India in 1935 by H.J. Taylor from Wilson College, Bombay, who studied alpha particles using special photographic emulsion. After this science congress, Bose and Chowdhuri embarked on detection of mesotrons using photographic plates and cosmic rays. So they took the photographic plates to high altitudes in Himalayas, choosing three stations, Mayapur Research Station in Darjeeling, Tanakpur and Farijan. And these plates were taken to these stations and then they were exposed to cosmic rays and then they were brought back and they developed and the events were studied. And they published four papers in Nature on these works after these observations. So what did they find? So if you see that this is the ionization track that they observed in Ilford plates. So they used what is called halftone plates, which had nuclear emulsion on one side. You can see a star-like event here, which I showed, which Blau and Wambacher had observed. And so they found heavy ionization tracks found in Ilford new halftone plates get exposed to cosmic rays and sunlight, where chiefly due to mesotrons. That's what they in the first paper. As per annual report of Bose Institute, it was written difficulty is being met with in obtaining photographing plates from England. Blau and Wambacher was also nominated by Erwin Schrödinger that year, but they did not get it. In fact, Blau and Wambacher were nominated twice, and in 1950 they got nominated with Powell. And the method was actually that the cosmic rays, this method works, that was shown by them first, but they did not get the prize. And Bose and Chowdhury was not nominated, and it was really a missed opportunity for India because they could not continue the research, although they were completely on the right track. Bibha Chowdhury decided to go to Manchester to work with PMS Blackett, who won the Nobel Prize in 1948. In Blackett's lab, she worked on penetrating particles associated with extensive air showers of cosmic rays. And this is the title of her thesis, Extensive Air Shower Associated with Penetrating Particles. And she submitted her thesis in 1949, but she was awarded in 1952. In 1949, she joined TIFR as a research fellow. By that time, she has not yet got her PhD degree, which she got in 1952. She continued her study on large air showers using cloud chamber techniques. In 1954, she joined Professor Leprin's Ringwait's lab at Ecole Polytechnique. What Dr. Bibha Chowdhury did was she studied properties of K mesons with multiple cloud chambers at a laboratory at Alps, and she published a paper in Nuovo Cimento. And you know, from it was not very easy because it was very cold, and one has to climb in the Alps, and it was really cold, and it was challenging atmosphere. But she continued her studies and published a paper. In 1957, she joined University of Michigan as a visiting lecturer and was involved in a research project on air showers using the technique of pulse ionization chamber in Professor V. Hansen's laboratory. Before leaving to India, she visited Professor Bruno Rossi at MIT. I mentioned that Professor Bruno Rossi was the first to discover the extensive air shower. So Dr. Bibha Chowdhury went there, and she worked on investigation of air showers using plastic scintillators. This is a handwritten CV of Bibha Chowdhury, which she submitted to PRL when she joined there. And you can see here, it's not very clear, but here you can see plastic scintillators. And then in R62, she started planning an experiment to study high energy muons greater than 150 GeV associated with extensive air showers. And then it was better to go to Kohler gold fields because one can go underground to detect the muons. And this work was done in planned collaboration with TIFR. Very briefly, the experiment was, that there was an underground detector with a plastic scintillator and neon flash tubes and photomultiplier tubes. And they measured the variation of total number of muons with energy greater than 150 GeV. And they published three papers out of this work. She left PRL in 1976. This is a group photo of Bibha Chowdhuri with her PRL colleagues. And Dr. Saxena told about her is she had an incredibly good understanding of the subject and was of great help in analyzing and interpretation of the experimental data. She came back to Calcutta after retirement in 1976. She continued to work with scientists from Calcutta University, SINP, VCC, and IACS. She worked on understanding nucleus-nucleus interactions at high energies and published about six papers. And her last paper was published in 1990 before she passed away in 1991. She was the first woman to do research in particle physics in India, and she did pioneering research on cosmic rays with so many Nature papers and, a paper which was close to Nobel Prize. And this was a pre-independent India, and she went abroad, did experimental research in a male-dominated field, and it showed exemplary courage and conviction. And it is completely a mystery that why she was so invisible and she was so hidden. When we see this, that her name was completely wiped out from scientific history, then the question arises that whether there was any gender discrimination. And so I read from the book by S.C. Roy and Rajinder Singh that here gender discrimination means that she was not elected as member of any of the three science academies, though her work was of high quality. Chowdhuri's name does not figure anywhere in the writing on cosmic particle research done at KGF. And in the editorial of a Physics News special issue, we wrote that while her male contemporaries, both at TIFR and PRL, went on to make substantial mark at national and international levels, unfortunately, Bibha Chowdhuri remained on the periphery in the subsequent years and was forgotten by the scientific community. But what is, the impression that I get is throughout her life, she remained unfazed by all the inattention, immersed in the pursuit of science. And the impression that I got is that, science was the main thing for her. In PRL, we are trying to revive her memory and I kind of felt an invisible bond because, we had so much similar trajectory. And which can be expressed maybe by this poem that Aji hote shoto borsho pare ke tumi poricho boshe amar kobita khani koutuhol pare. So it's not 100 years yet, and it was not a poem, but it was her, scientific work which I was going through. But somehow I felt an invisible bond with her.